The communion service is resumed. The whole people within the abbey and the countless thousands beyond its walls join in singing the old 100th psalm.
Thank you.
Her Majesty has descended from her throne and has moved to the steps of the altar. She's delivered the crown and the scepter and the rod to the Lord Great Chamberlain and other officers to hold. The Duke of Edinburgh comes to his footstool near the Queen and they kneel down together. Her Majesty, in accordance with a very ancient Christian tradition, offers bread and wine for the communion. And the Archbishop places them upon the altar.
Bless, O Lord, we beseech thee, these thy gifts, and sanctify them unto this holy use, that by them we may be made partakers of the body and blood of thine only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, and fed unto everlasting life of soul and body, and that thy servant Queen Elizabeth may be enabled to the discharge of her weighty office, whereunto of thy great goodness thou hast called and appointed her. Grant this, O Lord, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate.
Amen.
The Queen, still kneeling, offers a pall or altar cloth brought to her by the Lord Great Chamberlain. The Archbishop takes it and places it upon the altar. The Queen gives an ingot of gold of a pound weight. This offering is also placed by the Archbishop upon the altar. Her Majesty rises and moves to the footstool, to the south side. And the Duke of Edinburgh goes to the altar steps and, kneeling, makes his offering. Which is received by the Archbishop and placed upon the altar. And the Archbishop blesses the Duke of Edinburgh.
Almighty God, the fountain of all goodness, give ear, we beseech thee, to our prayers, and multiply thy blessings upon this thy servant, Philip, who with all humble devotion offers himself for thy service in the dignity to which thou hast called him. Defend him from all dangers, ghostly and bodily. Make him a great example of virtue and godliness, and a blessing to the Queen and to her peoples. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee, O Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, world without end.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom belongeth all power and dignity, prosper you in your honor, and grant you therein long to continue, fearing him always, and always doing such things as shall please him, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Duke rises, returns to the footstool by the Queen. As man and wife, they kneel together, and the Archbishop continues the service of Holy Communion.
Let us pray for the whole state of Christ's church militant here in earth. Almighty and ever-living God, who by thy holy apostle hast taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, we humbly beseech thee most mercifully to accept these oblations and to receive these our prayers which we offer under thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all they that do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. We beseech thee also to save and defend all Christian kings, princes, and governors, and especially thy servant Elizabeth, our queen, that under her we may be godly and quietly governed, and grant unto her whole council and to all that are put in authority under her, and that they may truly and indifferently minister justice to the punishment of wickedness and vice, and to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. We give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and curates, that they may both by their life and doctrine set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all thy people give thy heavenly grace, especially to this congregation here present, and that with meek heart and due reverence they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all them who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, and beseeching thee to give us grace so to follow their good examples, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant this, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate.
Amen.
To ye that do truly and earnestly repent you of your sin, and are in love and charity with your neighbors, and intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God, and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and make your humble confession to Almighty God, meekly kneeling upon your knee.
Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our many gross sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent, and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us, the burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us, have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. For thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we ever hereafter serve and please thee in the newness of life, the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all them that with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what comfortable words our Saviour Christ saith unto all that truly turn to him. Come unto me, all that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. So God loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Hear also what St. Paul saith, this is a true saying and worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Hear also what St. John saith, if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins.
Lift up your hearts.
That we should at all places and all times give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God, who hast at this time consecrated thy servant Elizabeth to be our queen, that by the anointing of thy grace she may be the defender of thy faith and the protector of thy church and people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table, but thou art the same Lord whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen.
The communion service reaches its climax in the prayer of consecration. The Archbishop solemnly recalls the death of Jesus Christ upon the cross for our redemption, and repeats the words spoken by our Saviour at the Last Supper on the same night that he was betrayed. This prayer will be heard only by those in the Abbey. But at its close, we shall hear the choir sing, O taste and see how glorious and gracious the Lord is. And at that moment, we shall know that the Queen and her husband are drawing near to the altar to receive the sacrament of the body and blood of Christ. During the silence and the music which follows it, the thoughts and prayers of us all will be intent upon our Queen as in humble faith she waits upon God.
Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. O Lord and Heavenly Father, we, thy humble servants, entirely desire thy fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. Here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and lively sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that all we who are partakers of this holy communion may be fulfilled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and although we be unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offences. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honour and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end.
Amen.
The great congregation in the abbey stand. The Queen rises, takes again and puts on St. Edward's crown, and receives again the scepter and the rod. With the sword carried before her, and supported by her bishops and attended by the peers who carried the regalia, Her Majesty ascends the steps of the throne. And is seated once again in the throne.
Glory be to God on high.
Thank you.
Prevent us, O Lord, in all our doings with thy most gracious favor, and further us with thy continual help, that in all our works begun, continued, and ended in thee, we may glorify thy holy name, and finally, by thy mercy, obtain everlasting life through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen. Amen.
The solemnity of the Queen's coronation ends with the glorious triumph of the Te Deum.
Thank you.
This is the signal, these fanfares for the beginning of the procession with which Her Majesty will depart from the Abbey. The Queen is still in St. Edward's Chapel, where, assisted by the Mistress of the Robes and attended by the Lord Great Chamberlain, she is being arrayed in her robe of purple velvet. And meanwhile, away down the Abbey, under the organ loft, I see the leading members of the procession, the officers of the Orders of Knighthood, in the sweeping robes of their orders, the scarlet satin mantles of the Order of St. Michael and St. George. There's the prelate of the order moving now under the organ screen in his Saxon blue mantle, lined with scarlet silk, and the gentleman usher of the Order of the Thistle in a mantle of green satin, and the Chancellor of the Order of the Garter in dark blue velvet lined with white, and the Knight's Grand Cross of the Order of the Bath in crimson silk satin. It's an amazing pattern of colour down below as this glorious procession moves out along the choir, and lining the choir are the Queen's bodyguard of gentlemen at arms in their red tunics and blue trousers trimmed with gold, and long plumes of white swan's feathers cascading from their helmets, waiting to escort Her Majesty. And now I see the Knights of the Garter, who held a canopy, wearing their garter mantles, blue over red velvet surcoats, in cloth of silver trunks and doublet, white silk hose, white shoes with silver rosettes, and the blue velvet garter with golden letters, and leading each order of knighthood of the gentlemen ushers of the purple rod, the blue rod, the green rod, and then preparing to move from the right side of the throne are the representatives of Ceylon, South Africa, Australia, Pakistan, New Zealand, Canada, the bearers of the standards, the Union Standard, the Standard of the Principality of Wales, the Royal Standard, the bearers who will take up their standards in the nave beyond the organ screen. Very slowly, the procession is moving out. All around the theatre is a dense mass of colour. Standing in the centre between St. Edward's chair and the throne are the six maids of honour. And behind the representatives and the standard bearers, I see the Prime Minister, Sir Winston Churchill. Behind him, behind the cross, the Archbishop of York. The Archbishop of Canterbury is still in St. Edward's Chapel, though he will join the procession shortly. And then the great mass of the bishops in their seats. And gradually the procession moves from the golden carpet of the theatre, and it is formed on both sides of the throne. The heralds have left their position by the great pillars and taken their appointed places, and now the prime ministers of the members of the Commonwealth are beginning to move, and Sir Winston Churchill turns round as he bears right into the nave for a last look at the high altar, and behind him the Cross of York and the Archbishop of York, and behind him in his wig with a coronet over it, the Lord High Chancellor, wearing a black mantle, gold embroidered. And behind him is borne a purse embroidered with the royal arms. And now Sir Winston Churchill goes down the steps to the nave, and the Earl Marshal is waiting the time when the procession has moved sufficiently for Her Majesty to join it. And soon taking his place will be the Duke of Edinburgh, followed by his midshipman page, coming from the chairs on the left of the theatre. And there I see now the sergeants at arms carrying great gilt maces, and the heralds of Richmond and York, Chester and Lancaster, and gleaming there the blades of the sword spiritual, the sword temporal, Gertana, the blunt sword of mercy borne by the Duke of Northumberland, the three swords standing ready to move abreast, standing just beyond the gold plate of the abbey just beyond the royal gallery where the Queen Mother waits to see her daughter join the procession. And there I see the coronets of Garter, principal king of arms, his coronet fringed with rose, and Narayan, Ulster king of arms, Clarencieux king of arms in their tabards, all part of this unimaginable pattern of colour grouped round the rose-red throne with its royal cipher in gold. And now the heralds move into the nave. The procession begins to move forward. The Lord Mayor of London bearing the crystal sceptre, part of it made in Saxon times, and by him the Lord Great Chamberlain, the Lord High Steward of Ireland, the High Constable of Scotland, the Great Steward of Scotland, and interspersed in this long procession, whose head has now reached the west door, I can just see over the organ loft, the standards passing through the west door, and interspersed in the procession of the pages attending peers and peeresses. They're 12 to 15 years old, wearing the livery colours of those they attend, claret or murrey or blue. The royal pages only in scarlet, and all of them in white breeches and stockings, lace cravats and ruffles, and wearing swords. What a day for the pages to remember. And all these wonderful robes and uniforms swirl down below, moving over the golden and the blue carpets, moving round the rose and gold throne, framed by the massed crimson and white of the peers and peeresses and the blue fabrics, moving under the golden royal gallery where the Queen Mother watches while we all wait to see her daughter proceed towards the west door, towards her people in the London streets. And when Her Majesty emerges from St. Edward's Chapel to form and join the procession, we shall hear the national anthem, and then we shall follow her procession as she departs from the abbey. Now the Marshal takes up his place, and the fanfares announcing the Queen will sound.